Good morning. I cannot tell you how good it is to be back. As you all know, we have been away for a couple of years. Not that it had anything to do with any of you or me, but there was something called a pandemic, which we could not be here. But I cannot begin to tell you how great it is to see all of you here today. And thank you so much for coming. And thank you for all of the folks that are watching by streaming today. This is the first time that we've had the opportunity to do this. We've got an exciting program for you today, so we want to kick it off. And so first let me introduce for a song, okay, Jamil McCantry, who is a singer-songwriter and an actor and a musical director. Did I leave anything out, Jamil? Who is currently one of our dedicated New York City public school teachers. We thank him for joining. Please give us a round of applause for Jamil.
Anybody who's speaking, please come over to this side and see me.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see through me. Dangers, toils, and snares I've had already come. 'Twas great my heart to fear, and grace will lead me home. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Brother McKeel, for that wonderful rendition. I understand you're going to be back a little bit later to do another song for us. Firstly, let me also thank the ASL interpreters, Mary Kay Adams and Andrea Eleffi, for doing the translations for us. Let me just start out before we get our program officially underway. Many of you know that I have been associated with this event, with the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire, for many, many years. And today I'm here absent a part of me. Many of you will know and remember a person by the name of Ed Vargas. Yeah, let's give him a round of applause. Who has worked with me on this event and others, the Remember the Triangle Fire Coalition, for many, many years. Eddie and I have been coming here for the last 30 years. And the last time I actually saw Eddie was right at this site 2 years ago, when we couldn't be here in person and we decided that we wanted to just do something. We had to do something. We decided that we would do it on a video. And Eddie suggested that we come together and we do a video together, which we did. Ironically, that was the last time that I saw my friend and my brother, Ed Vargas. But we would be remiss if we just did not give him a moment of acknowledgement for the work and the contribution that he made, not only to the continuance of this event, but also about the incredible memorial that is going to be installed on this building, which you're going to hear about a little bit later. Give a round of applause for Eddie Vargas. Just briefly, in the way of announcements, those of you that have been associated with this event and associated with what we do also know that we use this opportunity to ensure that workers, not only within the borders of the United States, but around the world, that they function and operate under decent living and working conditions. One of the things that has happened 10 years ago, and this is the 10th anniversary of a tragedy that happened in the country of Bangladesh, where a building collapsed and over 1,100 people died in that building collapse. And that building were garment workers, workers who do the very things that workers in this country here used to do. But as a result of that, we came together with our Global Union Federation, Industrial, and others around the world to make sure that we did something that those workers would never go have to go through anything like that again. And so we created a document known as the Bangladesh Accord, which spells out specifically, it was a document that was put together by the trade unions in Bangladesh, trade unions around the world, some brands, and I said some brands, not all of them, because I'm going to get to a point in a second, and the government of Bangladesh. We've negotiated an agreement which has changed the conditions. And what is interesting about that, the same thing that happened here in 1911 happened in Bangladesh in 2013. And the same way that we were able to get the laws changed the United States of America and the city and the state of New York, we were able to make significant progress in Bangladesh as well. However, many of the brands, the major brands in this country, did not sign on to the Bangladesh Accord. And we are still working with them, trying to do what we can. So I want to announce, on the 10th anniversary of the building collapse, that we're going to have a rally and demonstration at one of the leading brands in this country, Levi's. It will take place at Times Square on the Friday, the 21st of April, and you'll hear more about that, and we would like all of you to try to join us at that event. Today we have an exciting program for you. I know many of you that have been here before are wondering what all of this is all about. This is not the memorial. And we'll be talking about that in a little while, but that is the beginning and the preparation for what it's going to be. And we're going to be announcing shortly what we have in mind and what we hope to be able to do later this year. And so one of the things that we're going to do, those of you that have been here before, you know that after the ceremony, we lay a flower for each and call the name and the age of each one of the 146 people who passed away at this tragic event. We have a number of speakers today, and after they speak, each one of them will lay a flower at this site and at this corner. And so we hope that you'll bear with us. We know that it's a little bit chilly, but those of you that have been here before know that it's probably a little bit warmer than it has been in previous years. And so we thank you for your patience, we thank you for joining us, and we certainly thank you for being here. So getting started, if I may introduce our first speaker, and you know we always do an invocation at the beginning of this event. If I could welcome Rabbi Yael Werber, who will provide the invocation today. She is assistant rabbi at the CBST in Manhattan, a synagogue that promises and promotes social justice and actively supports the LGBTQ and immigrants' rights in our community. Please welcome Rabbi Werber.
Good morning. My name is Rabbi Yael Werber. I am the assistant rabbi at Congregation Beit Simchat Torah in Manhattan, and I feel so moved and honored to be here today. Not only because it's an honor to be a part of this beautiful ceremony commemorating a major event in American history that was such a catalyst for change and reform, but also because the victims of the Triangle Shirtwaist factory fire were largely immigrants from the Italian and Jewish communities. And so it feels especially meaningful and poignant to offer some words of opening blessing from the Jewish tradition, because I'm so able to clearly imagine the internal ritual and religious lives of so many who worked here. In Judaism, there is a deep tradition of having a blessing for every occasion. But when thinking of the devastation of this event, the loss of 146 lives, I felt myself at a loss for what type of blessing I could offer. How to make a blessing in a place of so much loss. However, it turns out I did find a blessing that felt right and appropriate. And that is the blessing of being in a dangerous and crowded place. Sound familiar? This is a blessing you say when you enter a place of great danger and fear. In a place of danger, there are four blessings you are supposed to say. First, you need to pray that you will enter in peace and leave in peace. That's two. However, here's the interesting part. There's an additional two blessings that Jewish tradition tells us we must pray in this type of scenario. It says, you must give thanks for the past and cry out for the future. We must give thanks for the past and cry out for the future. And that feels pretty perfect for this moment, this sacred site, this spot of so much sorrow and grief. We must first give thanks for the past, for those that came before us, those that unnecessarily lost their lives due to willful neglect and deliberately dangerous conditions. And yet, we must also shout about and cry out about the future, because this memorial and commemoration are not just about what has already happened, but also about looking ahead. We must acknowledge that there will always be more workers, more immigrants, more young people looking for opportunity who will come after this moment in time. And it is our job to shout loudly about what we can do for the future, what we can do for those who are still to come. We need to shout about the amount of organizing it takes to make change, as this moment in history did in creating long-lasting change and reform for workplace safety and workers' rights. And so I want to take this moment, this opening moment of this beautiful ceremony, and bless us with these two blessings. I want us to give thanks for the past. Thank you to all 146 names and lives that we honor today. Thank you for what you had to endure to wake up the nation to better conditions for the future. And I want us to shout out in prayer about the future. I want us to call in the future we want to live in, one with less opportunity for devastation and exploitation, and more opportunity for blessings and gratitude and communal gathering in joy. Thank you. And I'll start us off by saying that today we remember Pauline Horowitz, age 19, Ida Kanowitz, age 18, Ida Jukovsky, age 19, and Tessie Kaplan, age 18. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Werber. You know, one of the moving moments of the ceremony every year is the raising of the ladder on this building. 1911, the fire department's ladder could not reach up to that floor, and that's one of the reasons why so many people had to jump or they perished in the fire. And that had to be a devastating decision for them to have to make. But we are so grateful for the fire department for the support and the cooperation that they have given to us over the years in making this a very meaningful part of our ceremony. What I'd like to do is to introduce the Chief Inspector, Jesus Martinez, from the Fire Department of New York. We'd like to welcome Chief Inspector Martinez, who is the Director of the Bureau of Fire Prevention Training Academy for the Fire Department of New York City, to say a few words before raising the ladder on the building.
I must say I'm extra blessed to be here in the first time that you've had this in person. extra special to be here right now with you all. So it is truly an honor and a privilege to be here with you all for the fire department, but also as a member of this global community in remembering the 146 precious lives lost 112 years ago in the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire. Born out of this tragedy was not only the Bureau of Fire Prevention, but also a shared, unified, and collective approach in advocating safety for all, so that preventable fires, such as the one we're commemorating today, does not occur again. There is a quote from the noted British writer Nicholas Bentley, of whom also happened to be an auxiliary fireman and served in the London Fire Brigade during the Second World War, which is, "Learning history is easy. Learning its lessons seems almost impossibly difficult." The conditions that existed 112 years ago, when unchecked, sadly can and still exist to this day. You see, the times may have changed, but our mission has not. And on this day of remembrance, we are presented with a simple yet profound question. Aside from today, how do we continue to honor the lives lost? In the Fire Prevention Academy, when we educate our inspectors on the history of this tragic event and numerous others afterwards, there is one charge we give them that I humbly and honestly believe provides an answer to this question. Don't just see the building, see the people. On that fateful day, 146 lives woke up and went to work not knowing what would happen to them. They were fathers, mothers, brothers, sisters, aunts, uncles, sons, daughters, and friends, just like us. In essence, they were us. So as inspectors, this charge is a necessary reminder for our members to always see those who may otherwise feel unseen. Because just one life lost is one too many. So how do we demonstrate this? As inspectors, we do so by being steadfast and diligent to make every effort to leave every building safer than how we found it. And for our first responders, our firefighters and EMTs and paramedics, to always be at the ready for any emergency, just like they were 112 years ago. But we can't do this alone. So on behalf of the fire department, thank you to all who were present as you stand literally shoulder to shoulder with us today in how we answered the call in honoring all lives, past and present, by working together to make our city safe. Thank you. Members of Ladder 20, raise the aerial ladder. Today we remember Yetta Rosenbaum, Gussie Rosenfeld, Jenny Rosenberg, and Emma Rothstein.
Thank you very much, Inspector Martinez. We certainly continue to appreciate the work that you and your department has been doing. For more than 100 years, the Worker Circle has actively promoted progressive Jewish culture and social action have been integral in honoring the victims of the Triangle Fire and their families. Today, young people, and we're certainly glad to have these young people with us so they can understand and learn and remember the history of what happened at this site many years ago. Young people from their youth group will tell a story about the Triangle Fire. Let's give them a round of applause and thank them for being with us.
The Triangle Waste Company was located in the top three floors of the Ash Building, just one block east of Washington Square Park.
The bosses, known for their fierce anti-unionism, were on the top floor.
Beneath them, hundreds of workers on the 8th and 9th floors filled long lanes of sewing machines. Many were sisters, friends, or neighbors.
On March 25th, 1911, at closing time, a fire broke out on the 8th floor of the factory.
The brief moment between the start of the fire and when it began to spread gave most of these workers the chance to escape.
A warning was sent to the 10th floor where the bosses worked. All but one person on the 10th floor was able to get out.
On the 9th floor, there was no warning. The fire spread beneath them. In an instant, they were engulfed in flames.
The workers raced to find a path to escape. There were two staircases, a fire escape and an elevator.
The Washington Place staircase was locked. No one on the 9th floor escaped through that exit.
Others found the fire escape, which quickly filled with desperate workers. Suddenly, it broke away from the building, dropping them to their death.
A barrel of machine oil by the last remaining staircase exploded.
The brave elevator operator was no match for the fast-spreading flames. Soon, workers were leaping into the elevator shaft to escape the fire.
On the street, witnesses watched in horror as the windows filled with workers trapped by the fire.
There was a moment of hope when the fire truck arrived, but the ladder could only reach to the 6th floor, well below the burning loft.
The workers began to jump.
In less than half an hour, 146 young workers, most of them immigrants, most of them Jewish or Italian-American, women and girls perished.
There was a trial, but despite the locked door, the owners were acquitted.
Here is the 9th floor.
Here is the 10th floor.
Here is the fire escape.
Here is the pavement they crashed through.
Here is the elevator.
Here is the scene.
Here are the Triangle workers.
We remember the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire, mourn the dead, and fight like hell for the living.
We remember Ida Pearl, age 20,
Rose Mankowski, age 22,
Jacob Seltzer, age 33,
Benjamin Kurtz, age 19.
Thank you so much. Let's give another round of applause for the young people. We really appreciate your participating. Now it gives me a great honor and pleasure to introduce somebody I've known for a very long time, a good friend, the commissioner of the Labor Commissioner of the State of New York, Roberta Reardon. Give her a round of applause, please. Yes, sir. Prior to working in government, Roberta Reardon taught labor lessons, labor relations, and served as president of the American Federation of Television and Radio Artists after, and later SAG after, which it became when it merged with the Screen Actors Guild. As Commissioner of Labor, she was instrumental in getting New York State to support the New York, the Triangle Fire Memorial. And let me just say, a lot of people have put in a lot of work in this effort, but Roberta Reardon was one of the people who stood tall in terms of making sure that this event not only happened, but this memorial got put on this building. So please join me in giving a warm round of applause for Commissioner of Labor of the State of New York, Roberta Reardon.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, everybody. It is such an honor to join you today as we remember the victims who perished in this horrific tragedy that forever changed the fight for workers' protections. Thank you, Edgar, my dear friend, for that wonderful introduction. You know, Edgar has been advocating for workers' rights and protections for more than 50 years. I thank you for paving the way for future generations of workers as Secretary Treasurer at Workers United. Let's give a big round of applause. More of him, please. I'd also like to acknowledge the President of the New York City Council, Labor Council, Vinny Alvarez. Vinny too has dedicated his life to the labor movement. Thank you for being such a relentless fighter for the thousands of union members that you represent. And of course, a very big shout out to all of our labor friends here, the community friends, and our elected leaders who have joined us for this incredible observation. I think many here would agree that it would be impossible to visit this spot without thinking about our dear friend, Ed Vargas. In fact, the very first time I was here as Commissioner of Labor, I was with Ed. He was the embodiment of the department's mission to protect workers. And we owe him a very large debt of gratitude for his work to make sure that this state is a safer place in which to live and work. Thank you. Ed and many of you here today are the reason we will have a permanent memorial on this facade, in the building where the fire took place. You know, the tragedy is the workers died, the building is still here. We continue our work in his memory. And in fact, many of the people who are on the front lines of that work are here today. Thank you for your efforts. Now, I am so proud today to be joined by my department colleagues from our worker protection team. They work tirelessly to protect New York's public employees, and that is a monumental task considering the variety of jobs in the public sector and the unique risks associated with those jobs. Protecting workers regardless of their immigration status, as well as protecting young workers, remains at the forefront of the work that they do each and every day, and I thank them for joining me today. We're also joined by some of our partners from the U.S. Department of Labor, who model the same passion for keeping workers safe and healthy. When our workplaces are safe, it creates a positive ripple effect throughout society, and we are grateful for your partnership. Governor Kathy Hochul remains a steadfast ally in our mission to safeguard our workforce. As someone who grew up in a labor household, she fully understands how important it is to ensure the safety of all workers, regardless of their trade. She continues to champion the improvement of working conditions statewide. Many view the shirtwaist fire as the catalyst for the modern American movement for worker safety and the protocols that we have in place today. It was an event that inspired one of my own personal heroes, Frances Perkins, to begin her fierce crusade. Yes, she was an amazing woman. She started her fierce crusade against poor safety conditions for workers because what she witnessed here that day. It was also the genesis behind the development of the Department of Labor. As we remember the Triangle workers who died needlessly in this fire, we should also remember the uprising of the 20,000 workers who attempted to prevent this tragedy. just over a year before the fire, tens of thousands of workers, mostly women garment workers, went on an 11-week strike across the city to demand better pay, safer working conditions, and the right to unionize. The strikers won only a portion of their demands because the owners of the Triangle Shirtwaist Company and other male-owned garment businesses used every tool available to them, both legal and illegal, to fight against unionization. However, the uprising and the loss of so many lives in this tragedy sparked 5 years of revolt that transformed the garment industry into one of the best organized trades in the United States. The Triangle Fire challenges all of us to do our part, to stand with our sisters and brothers and fight for social and economic justice and the safety of all of our workplaces. And we continue to fight to ensure that no worker ever suffers again as these workers suffered. The memory of those lost here today so many years ago shall remain forever in our minds as we take bold action to continue to protect workers in the state of New York. Please join me in remembering the victims of the fire and their families as we honor their legacy. Today, we remember Lizzie Adler, 24, Vincenza Benanti, 23, Vincenza Bellotto, 15, and Yetta Berger, 18.
Thank you so much, Commissioner Reardon. Now it gives me the pleasure to introduce someone I've known for a very long time, very well, and somebody who's very well known, certainly here in the city of New York. He's Vinny Alvarez, president of the New York City Central Labor Council. Please give him a hand. Vinny represents 1.3 million workers and over 300 unions in the city of New York. And I have to share with you that one of the reasons why we have been able to accomplish so much and what we have done here in connection with the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire is because of Vinny Alvarez and the New York City Central Labor Council. And I would be remiss if I didn't express my deep thanks and appreciation to you, Vinny, and to Brendan Griffin, okay, who's really stepped up and helped us, because nothing happens by itself and no one person could do any of this alone. And so many people have come together, and I cannot express my deep feeling sufficiently enough to thank Vinny Alvarez. So please give him a wonderful round of applause for his contribution, not only for what he does in connection with the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire, but what he does for the workers in the city of New York. Vinny Alvarez.
Thank you, Edgar. Well, thank you, Edgar, and thank you, Brendan, as well. So today we gather to remember the 146 lives that were lost 112 years ago, but we're also here to recommit in the fight to protect all working people throughout this city. Whether your workplace is a garment factory, whether it's a classroom, whether it's a construction site, a nail salon, wherever it is, anywhere in between, let us remember the lessons that were learned here at the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire. You know, the fire was a defining moment in the history of labor, women, immigrants, worker safety, and of New York. It taught us that workplace protection can never be passive. We know that worker protection takes action, it takes advocacy, it takes education, and we need to stand together each and every day as a movement to make sure that workers in this city, across this state, and across this country, when they go to work, that they go home each and every day safely. That is our commitment to them. All working people are empowered by knowing the history of the labor movement struggle. And so on behalf of the entire New York City labor movement, we thank you all for joining us here today to mourn for the dead and commit ourselves once again to fighting for the safety and the dignity of all working people. So thank you all. And today we remember Celia Eisenberg, age 17. Rebecca Fibish, age 20. Dora Evans, age 18. And Yetta Fichtenholtz, age 18. Thank you.
Thank you so much, President Penny Alvarez. Our next speaker is Nancy Hagans, who is the president of the New York State Nurses Association, the oldest nurses union in the nation, representing more than 42,000 registered nurses across the state of New York. Ms. Hagans is a nurse and a critical care expert who has for over 30 years of experience at Maimonides Medical Center in Brooklyn, New York, and is an active member of the union social justice committee, ensuring the health and safety of her members and patients, and has always been a priority in her life. Please welcome Nancy Hagans.
Thank you. Good afternoon. It's an honor to join you here today to commemorate the anniversary of the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire, and to memorialize the 146 workers, mostly immigrant women and girls, who perished on March 25, 1911. This tragedy became a clarion call to improve working conditions in New York and throughout the country. The terrible working conditions that led to this preventable tragedy spurred action from the labor movement on health and safety and workers' right, and help enact laws that protects us today. As a union of nurses and healthcare professionals who are predominantly women and include many immigrants, women like me, NYSNA is still answering the call to our better working conditions. Nursing is a dangerous profession. Nurses experience some of the highest injury rates. Nurses are regularly exposed to violence, musculoskeletal injuries, chemical and biological exposures, including infectious disease like COVID-19 and more. Unsafe staffing level, chronic in U.S. hospitals and nursing homes leave us even more exposed to this hazard, and of course, also present a risk to our patient that we find unacceptable. NYSNA nurses at 12 private hospitals just concluded a successful contract campaign aiming to part to improve safe staffing, health and safety in our workplaces. Two hospitals, Montefiore in the Bronx and Mount Sinai in Manhattan, went on a three-day strike to win safe staffing and respect for our nurses and patients. The nurses' struggle captured the world's attention and highlighted the ongoing need to protect workers. Though fearlessly organizing and demanding better condition, NYSNA nurses were able to win groundbreaking agreements that improve condition in New York City hospitals and give frontline workers a stronger voice in staffing and in health and safety, including pandemic planning. We are proud of our accomplishment and also humbled by the knowledge that we are walking in the footsteps of labor and other activists and building upon their accomplishment, sacrifice, and yes, their tragic death. The anniversary of the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire also falls in March, the anniversary of COVID-19 pandemic. After the experience of being the front line of a pandemic and experiencing the death at a level that we had never experienced before, after losing dozens of our colleagues in the death of battle against COVID, and after seeing that some of his pain and loss that was preventable, NYSNA nurses gained the courage to fight for what we know is right. I can't think of a better way to honor the legacy of the women and girls who perished in the Triangle Fire. Like they did more than 100 years ago, we turned tragedy into action. We fought for a better world for ourselves and those and who will one day walk into our shoes. So thank you. And today, we remember Gorsi Bierman, age 22. Abraham Benevitz, age 30. Katharina Bona, Gianna Stanazzo, age 22. Rosa Bona Bassino, age 33.
Thank you very much, Nancy, for those inspiring words. We appreciate your being here for the first time, and we look forward to you coming back in years to come. Our next speaker is Hannah Gurman, who is the Contract Faculty United of the UAW. Let's hear it for the UAW. Stand in the back there, all right. Hannah teaches at NYU University, Gallatin School, and specializes in U.S. Foreign relations. She is active in organizing with Contract Faculty United, UAW, to ensure meaningful improvements to salaries, benefits, and working conditions for academic workers like herself, because she is one as well. Please welcome Hannah Gurman.
Hi, everyone. I'm Hannah Gurman, and I'm a professor at NYU's Gallatin School of Individualized Study, and I'm here representing Contract Faculty United, the Union for Continuing Contract Faculty at NYU. Woo! I am honored and humbled to be with you all today to remember the 146 people who worked in this building and who died here because their bosses put their own interests over the safety of their workers. This tragedy bears personal meaning for me. Many of the women and men who died in the fire were Jewish immigrants from Eastern Europe. This is my family's history. In 1911, many of my relatives were working low-level jobs in the garment industry in cities across America. As we know, this industry was crucial in building the modern labor movement in this country. And the sad truth is that the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire petitions into supporting basic safety protections that the ILGWU had long been demanding, protections that we all benefit from today. Even as we remember this past, it's important to acknowledge that the movement to build and maintain workers' rights is ongoing. In New York City and around the world, garment industry workers continue to fight for safe conditions and living wages. They know that the only way to guarantee these things is through a union. Workers, yes, workers in higher education also know this. And the people who teach in the Brown Building, which is now owned by NYU, know that unions are essential for job security. Who teaches in the Brown Building today? Adjunct faculty, proud members of ACT UAW Local 7902. Woo! Which successfully negotiated a great contract with the administration last semester. Graduate students, proud members of GSOC, UAW, Local 2110. Tenure track faculty who have job security through tenure. And contract faculty. Neither adjuncts nor tenure track faculty, we work on the basis of contracts that need to be renewed every 1, 3, or 5 years. Most people don't know about contract faculty. yet we make up 50% of full-time faculty at NYU. Half. And we are the only ones who teach in the Brown Building and across NYU without real job security. Security that only a union or tenure can provide. What we are asking NYU for is simple: to support a neutral process for recognizing our union, which has already won the support of a majority of its members. If they do this simple thing, they honor the legacy of the workers who died here 112 years ago today. But if they continue to stall and delay, we can only conclude that they have learned nothing from this history. We're still waiting for Andy Hamilton, the president of NYU, to respond to our simple request. Andy, how much longer before you do the right thing? Thank you. Today we remember Anna Cohen, age 25. Sarah Cooper, age 16. Anna Coletti, age 36. Michelina Cordiano, age 30.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Anna. How are we doing out there? You all right? I'm trying to turn the heat up a little bit for you. It's not as cold as it was about a half an hour ago. Just keep moving, you know, just shake your body. That certainly would help. So now that you've acknowledged that you're doing all right, I'd like to bring back Jamel McCantry for another song. Is that all right? Let's hear from Jamel again. Jamel?
Broken down and tired of living life on the merry-go-round, and you can't find the fighter, but I see it in you, so we gonna walk it out and move mountains. We gonna walk it out and move mountains. And I'll rise like the day. I'll rise unafraid. I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. And I'll rise up, in spite of the ache. I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. For you, for you, for you, for you. When the silence isn't quiet, feels like it's getting hard to breathe, and I know you feel like dying, but I promise we'll bring the world to its feet and move mountains, bring it to its feet and move mountains. And I'll rise like the day. I'll rise up in spite of the ache. I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. For you, for you, for you. All we need, All we need is hope, and for that we have each other. And for that we have each other. Yeah. We will rise, we will rise. Oh, we will rise. Oh, we'll rise. And I'll rise up, I'll rise like the day. I'll rise up in spite of the ache. I will rise 1,000,000 times again. And we'll rise up, we'll rise like the wave. We'll rise up, we'll rise unafraid. We'll rise up, and we'll do it 1,000 times again. For you, for you. Today, we remember Becky Ostrovolsky, age 20. Providenza Pano, age 42. Annie Pack, age 18. Anna Pasqualicchio Ardito, age 28.
Thank you very much, Jamil, for your participation and for that wonderful, two wonderful songs that you blended for us today. Give Jamil another round of applause. For as many years as I can remember us having this event, we've always been fortunate enough to have a number of politicians come, but one of the officers that have always attended has been the borough president of Manhattan. A little while ago we had, and I believe she has left, but a former borough president of Manhattan and not currently member of the city council, Gail Brewer, has always participated. And we are very fortunate to have our latest borough president of Manhattan, Mark Levine, participating with us today, carrying on that great tradition. President Mark Levine is a former bilingual math and science teacher and founder of the Neighborhood Trust Federal Credit Union. Prior to being elected borough president of Manhattan, he was a member of the city council and focused on tenants' rights, public health, and school equity, public transportation, parks, and housing. Please welcome borough president of Manhattan, Mark Levine.
Thank you very much. You forgot former U of T member. Can you please give it up for an icon of the American labor movement, Edgar Romney? Thank you, thank you. And thank you to the whole Workers United family for carrying the torch. This has been such a moving ceremony already. Oh my goodness, the voice of Jamil McKinstry. Oh my goodness. Did you know that he is a current public school teacher and U of T member? Please give it up for Jamil again. And I don't know if the young people from Worker Circle are still here, but you were so good. They're here, they're making noise. You guys give me hope for the future. Thank you so much. The tragedy that occurred here 112 years ago, this was not just a scene of loss. This was a crime scene. The 146 women and girls and children, some of the names we've heard today, ages 15 and 16. They died because of the actions of bosses. Bosses who even before the fire had created deeply exploitative conditions, turned their workplace into a fire track, and then locked the doors. I don't know what the court said back then. This was a crime scene. And I am proud of this city for not just mourning after this tragedy, but for rising up. The funeral service after this fire is still today one of the largest marches in New York City history. Over 350,000 people came out to march to demand that this would not happen again, to demand that people would be kept safe in their workplaces, to demand the end of 16-hour workdays, to demand the end of 15-year-olds being sent into sweatshops. And they won those fights. This was a landmark in the history of American labor. We turned that tragedy into progress for workers. That was led by women, led by women. I'm sorry to say that around the world today, despite this progress, there are other triangle shirtwaist factories in other parts of the world today. And there are workers today in this country who are still fighting for their right to organize, including here at NYU. We support you, Professor Hannah Garman, and your fellow faculty, contract faculty, and your right to join UAW. We support you. There are workers fighting for safety on the job today in America, in hospitals. We support you, Nancy Hagans and NYSNA. There are workers fighting for safety in internet fulfillment warehouses. We support them. We support the Amazon Workers Union. There are workers fighting for safety on construction sites. Too many jobs are still dangerous today in America. Our fight must continue. You know, the 146 women who were murdered here were never properly individually memorialized. And there's no denying the fact that that is in part because they were marginalized, immigrant, poor women from Jewish and Italian backgrounds. 112 years later, we are finally going to rectify that injustice. We're going to finally do it right here, right here. And let the record show that, again, it was women who stood up to get this memorial built. I don't know if Marianne Trasciatti is here. Are you? She is the woman who is the president of the Memorial Association. They have been fighting for well over a decade through an unbelievably Kafka-esque bureaucratic approval process. They have done it. This is opening in October. And it's going to be inspiring, evoking the image of a ribbon of the type that the women and girls who were here might have had in their hands at the moment of the fire. Will you all please pledge to come back here for the unveiling of this memorial? Good. We will be back to remember the New Yorkers who died here and to recommit for the fight for workers everywhere. Now it's my profound honor to acknowledge some of those who were lost together with our FDNY ceremonial unit. Esther Goldstein, age 20. Mary Goldstein, age 18. Lena Goldstein, age 22. Bertha Greb, age 25. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Borough President Mark Levine. We certainly appreciate those comments and appreciate your support. The next person that I'd like to introduce, find my note here, is Chris Mate, Councilman Chris Mate. And Chris, we haven't met yet, but we have something in common. I noticed that you're born and raised on the Lower East Side. And so was I, probably a few years ago. So we'll have to get together and catch up, all right, talk about the Lower East Side, because I'm sure my story may be a little bit different than yours may have been. But let's welcome the member of council, City of New York, okay, Chris Mate from the Lower East Side.
Every year I come here, I ask myself, what has changed? What has changed since that day? And in many respects, not much. Tens of thousands of women who are former garment workers and now home attendants have the same sweatshop conditions that these women and children had. Every single day across New York City, immigrant women of color are working 24-hour shifts for 13 hours of pay. Many of them don't sleep. Many of them break their backs. Many of them don't see their children, their husband, their homes for days on end. How do I know this? Because my mom was a home attendant. She worked 24-hour shifts. I would see her leave and not come back. And when she did, she would sleep for 12, 13 hours, get back up, and go back to work. And so what have we learned? I look at my colleagues in the city council. I look at my colleagues in the state. When these women organize and march and protest in the street, many of these same elected officials that say they're for workers ignore them. When they're for immigrant women of color, they ignore them. What have we learned? There's a crime happening in New York City every single second. And many of us have choose to look the other way. I ask you all, when you leave this, don't just think of this as a nice ceremony and you'll be back next year. I want you to think, what will you do tomorrow? Would you call to put an end to the 24-hour shifts? This modern slave-like labor that happens in the homes are the most vulnerable. People with disabilities, people who are bedridden, people who can't use the restroom on their own terms. We have to do more so the women and the children who lost their lives that day are not in vain. We have to call our elected officials and say, not only do these women need a pay raise, and not only do we have to support them and come to rallies, we have to change the law to stop this inhumane practice. In a few weeks, we will be in front of City Hall with these women who will come out in numbers. And I ask you to stand with them, to protest with them, and to call on your elected officials and say, please end this practice. We are not only here for workers today, but we're here for workers every day. No matter who you are, no matter what you look like, and no matter where you work. If you stand with workers, you stand with everyone. Because when we're divided, when we let special interests get in our way, when we allow government to tell us this isn't impossible, we know what will happen. Women will die. Today, we remember Mary Leventhal, 22. Pauline Levin, 19. Jeannie Levin, 19. Rose Larmark, 19. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Councilman Mate. Our next speaker is somebody that I've had the opportunity to know and actually worked with a long time. I actually served on her board for a while, and it is Ann Toback, who is a longtime activist from a union family. Ann Toback previously served as the Assistant Executive Director of the Writers Guild of America East before becoming the Workers' Circle Woman's Leader in 2008. She was the first leader to do that, so give her a round of applause for that. Ann is focused on the organization's efforts on prioritizing immigrants' rights, economic justice, activism, worker protection and fighting against the national rise of hatred, racism, and anti-Semitism. Please welcome Ann Toback, Worker Circle.
Thank you. Thank you, Edgar. Thank you, everyone from the Triangle Fire Commemoration Organization who helps put this on every year and allows us this opportunity to get together and be heard. From our founding in 1900, when we served as an immigrant rights organization through succeeding decades, when we worked to help build the union movement in America, the Workers' Circle has been a progressive Jewish social justice organization passionately committed to standing up against intolerance, inequity, and bias. In 1911, we stood side by side with our brothers and sisters in the labor movement and mourned our members and friends who died in this tragedy. 146 workers, mostly women, Jewish and Italian immigrants, forced to work in sweatshops where their lives were valued less than the shirt waists they produced. A tragedy all the more heartbreaking because it could have been prevented. The Triangle factory owners were viciously anti-union and fought back many attempts by their workers to organize and gain union protections. The owners played a leading role in fighting the 1909 general strike of over 20,000 immigrant women, shirtwaist workers who walked off their jobs demanding safe working conditions, reasonable hours, and a living wage. The Triangle owners hired thugs to physically attack the strikers and continued their anti-union campaign even after the strike successfully concluded with over 85% of the shirtwaist factories covered by union contracts. But the Triangle factory remained unorganized and their owners' greed unchecked, and 146 workers paid the ultimate price. In 1911, the Workers' Circle buried 25 victims of the fire, including Rose Mell, who was 15, and Sarah Cooper, who was 16. Today, over a century after the uprising of the 20,000 and the Triangle Shirtwaist tragedy, working people in the United States find themselves fighting against extraordinary attacks on every angle of their lives. Workplace safety regulations put in place after 1911 fire are now weakened or in jeopardy of elimination. The right to collectively bargain, collect union dues, and to organize are all under attack. Each year, the advent of the Triangle commemoration immediately precedes Passover, one of the earliest stories of workers collectively rising up against their oppressors and undertaking an exodus to their promised land. Today, we must fight to keep America the 21st century promised land for everyone, for workers, for immigrants, and for the people of every race and ethnicity whose diversity makes us a country of opportunity for all. Today, as we recite the names of the Triangle's 146 victims, let us remember, commemorate, and commit in their memory to answering today's call to action for immigrant rights, for worker safety, and civil liberties started more than a century ago to make sure that terrible history doesn't repeat itself. And today we remember Max Florin, 23, Diana Gorjoy, age 18, Rose Friedman, age 18, Masha Gerstein, age 17.
Thank you very much, Ann. Our next speaker is somebody very special to me and should be very special to all of us, because Susan Pratt Bass actually lost a few family members in this event. Actually, she had two aunts, one survived and one perished in the fire. And I've come to respect this woman immensely because of the work and contribution that she has made in helping and developing and everything that we needed to do to make this memorial that you're going to hear about after Suzanne a reality. So please, and Suzanne represents the family of the, also an integral part of the work that we do in helping to build a memorial, and she serves on the Triangle Fire. She's a board member of the Triangle Fire Coalition. So please welcome Suzanne Pratt Bass.
Hello and welcome to all you intrepid souls who are out here today. As Edgar said, I am Suzanne Pred-Bass, a board member of the Remember the Triangle Fire Coalition and a family member of two of the workers in the Triangle Factory Fire. I had two great aunts in the fire who were at the factory that fateful day. Rosie Wiener, who died in the fire, and Katie Wiener, who survived. It is my great pleasure today to welcome all the family members who are present today, and those who aren't but have loyally supported us as we near completion of the memorial. Thank you for coming. Here are the names of family members who are here today and the names of their relatives who died. Ellen Gruber Garby for Jacob Bernstein and Morris Bernstein. Rita Bobry for Nettie Driansky. Erica Lansner, Gabby Lansner, and Phyllis Cohn for Fanny Lansner. Nekamaya Aaron Oberstein for Julia Oberstein. Lou Miano for his aunt Santina Salemi, his cousin Rita Cerrito, and their friend Josie Del Castillo, the three girls from Cherry Street. Here for Annie Nicholas, and a special shout out to Jane Fazio-Valita and her sisters and son Nick, who are here for the incredibly courageous elevator operator who saved so many lives, Joe Zito. If I have omitted anyone, could you please raise your hand, say your name? Hey, pretty amazing. Okay. Dee Dee Friedman for Bessie Dashevsky. All right. As we have worked on getting the memorial designed and installed, you family members have always been carried in our thoughts and hearts. And as they say, you are the wind beneath our sails. Thank you. Today we remember Rose Mell, 15. Yetta Myers, 19. Gaetana Midolo, 15. Annie Miller, 16.
Thank you very much, Suzanne. And our final speaker is somebody who's also worked very hard and very diligently in getting this memorial built, and she's going to tell us a little bit about it. Rosen Parado is a board member of the Remember the Triangle Fire Coalition, and somebody I got to learn and work with very well, and really honored to have had that opportunity for her dedication and commitment to getting this memorial done. So please welcome Rose Imperato. Rose.
Hey, girl! Oh, my God. We're back 4 years later. Oh, my God. Richard Jr., I can't even tell you. To see everybody out here again, we haven't been out here since 2019. It was really hard to not be out here on the site when they shut down the city in March 2020. I want to know, can I see a show of hands of people here who were at the 2011 100th anniversary of the Triangle Fire? Can I see a show of hands? This is what I'm saying. You don't need an introduction to why we're here. Can I see a show of hands of people who identify as being part of the Remember the Triangle Fire Coalition board, advisory board, volunteers, people who have been to events here? Can I see a show of hands of people who are part of a union? Can I see a show of hands of people who care about worker safety and have ever been at a rally for worker safety? Can I hear some applause for what we're doing together? What are, you know, seriously, 112 years ago, the workers who worked in this building, yeah, they mourned. They wanted to do something fitting. They wanted to have some sort of a national monument to say, this happened. This changed our lives. This changed everybody's life. But they didn't have time. They were busy trying to stop other fires from happening. They were busy trying to organize themselves. They were trying to stay alive. So we're here to say to those workers, we did it. This generation finally is going to put up on this building the Triangle Fire Memorial, and the country and the world will come and see it. So thank you, all of you, for being part of this. I see so many faces of people, and I met somebody named Lauren. I don't know if she's here still. She's a student at NYU, and she's an activist. So this is what I'm talking about. Kim's daughter is out here today. How old are you now? 8? Seriously, she's 8 years old. I wish when I was 8 years old, I was holding the name of a worker, you know, to remember them. But we're going to keep this tradition going. This memorial will go up on this building. We've been working on this, over a decade, but there's a lot of bureaucracy in New York City. NYU and we are, the Remember the Triangle Fire Coalition have been working for about 12 years to figure out how to do this. The scaffolding is here. I can tell you some great news. Oh, and by the way, there are a lot of people right now on the YouTube channel of Casa Italiana. Thank you so much to those folks for carrying this on the live stream. It's on our Facebook page. So welcome to all of you, too. Thank you for being a part of this. And I'll just wrap to say that 2 days ago, we got certification from our engineering team and the architects working on this that we are good to go to install on the building. You know, we wanted to get that in time for today's event. So Workers United is in the house. So happy to see all of you. So please put on your calendars, save the date in the month of October. We will be out here. We're meeting with NYU next week to firm up if it's going to be the second week or the third week or the fourth week of October. But just circle it. Don't make any plans. Plan to be here because we're going to fill up all of these streets as we unveil the Triangle Fire Memorial. So thank you, everybody, for being here. Seriously, in the cold and... you know, will you come back? I know Mark Levine asked. Will you come back?
Yes.
Okay. Today we remember Israel Rosen, 17 years old. His mother also died in the fire with him. Julia Rosen, 35 years old. Emilia Prato, she was 21. Jenny Pildescu was 18 working here. Vincenza Pinello, he was 30. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rose. And this actually concludes our program, and let me thank all of you for coming. And also, again, as Rose indicated, we will be dedicating this memorial sometime in the month of October. Hopefully we'll know an exact date, you know, in the next few weeks so that we can get it out to everybody. So we expect to have... Now, I was told that the 100th anniversary, we had about 15,000 people. Those of you that were here remember that the podium was there, and we had people going all the way back over to Broadway. This year, we would like to try to surpass that, and we're going to go to work on that now that we know that we've got a date. So we look forward to all of you coming back. Will I see you again in October? Yes. All right. So, and finally, we have some flowers. Those of you that would like to come and lay a flower at the sidewalk here and announce a name, please just line up. We would appreciate as many people that would like to do that. Thank you so much for coming, and we'll see you in our...
They're coming from two different directions.
So people come from this direction, please, the other side, not the back. So please come to the front, to the front.
Yeah, if you would come this way, if you'd like to lay a flower and call a name, please come over to the right here, all right, over by the fire truck. And what you'll do, you have a flower in your name, please announce the name of the person on the flower, and the fire department will toll the bell on behalf of that individual. Thank you.
Sarah Sebasiewicz, 17. Teresa Schmidt, 32. Ethel Schneider, 20. Laura Brunetti, 18.
So, Nancy.
Sam Leher, 19. Max Leher, 18. Mariana Annie Labatt, 16. Jenny Lederman, 21.
Isabella Tortorelli, age 17.
Her sister, Maria Giuseppe Tortorelli Lalati, age 33, mother of five children.
Fanny Lansner, age 21.
Maria Moralia, age 30.
Jacob Bernstein, 38. His cousin Morris Bernstein, 19.
Fanny Rosen, 21 years old.
Anna Altman, 16.
Francesca Caputo, 16. Berta Kula, 19.
Rosie
Weiner, 23.
Becky Kessler, 19.
Rachel Grossman, 18.
Josephine Camorata, 17.
Antonietta Pasqualicchio, only 15 years old.
Concetta Prestifilippo, 22.
Sam Tabak, 20.
Emma Driansky, age 21.
Our beloved Nettie Leibowitz, age 25.
Dora Welfowitz, 21.
Rose Sorkin, 18.
Becky Rhines, 18.
Santina Salemi, age 24. Rosina Cerrito, age 18. And Josie Del Castillo, age 20.
Mayor Utah, 23.
Julia Oberstein, age 19.
Kalman Dunick, age 24, and Margaret Schwartz, age 24.
Essie Bernstein, age 19.
Jacob Klein, age 23. Becky Ostrowski, age 20.
Becky Kopeman, 16. Jenny Stuglitz, 22. Josephine Calese, age 34.
Frida Belakowski, age 20. Tilly Coppersmith, age 16.
Joseph Wilson, age 22. Kate Leon, age 14.
Bessie Dashevsky, age
21.
Clara Dockman, 19.
Katerina Maltese, 39.
Lucia Maltese, 20. Rosaria Maltese, 14.
Annie Nicholas, 18. Daisy Lopez Fitz, 26.
Rosie Brenman, 23. Tessie Wiener, 21.
Michelina Nicolosi, age 23.
Mary Herman, age 40.
Jenny Stein, age 18.
Albina Caruso, 20.
Bessie Viviano, 15.
Theodore Ratner, age 22.
Rosie Shapiro, 17. Grazia Maria Floresta, 30.
Annie Starr, age 30. Sarah Weintraub, age 17.
Serafina Saracino, 25, and her sister, Teresina Saracino, from East Harlem.
Bettina Maiale, age 18. Francesca Maiale, age 19.
Louis Loeb Rosen, 33. Sadie Nussbaum, 18.
Esther Housefield, 21. Colonai Taranova, 23.
Bertha Wendroff, age 18. Ben Sclover, age 25.
Anna Ciminello, age 36.
Sonia Wysotsky, age 17. Yetta Goldstein, age 20.
Rose Oranger, 19.
Becky Neubauer, age 19.
Rosa Grasso, age 14. Giovanna Stellino, age 17.
Sarah Brenman, age 17. Fanny Hollander, age 18.
Golda Sprunt, age 19.
Sarah Brodsky, 21. Ida Brodsky, 15.
Catherine Uzo, 22.
Contragina Franco, 15.
So we will also lay red flowers for anyone who has died this year at work. Thank you all for coming.